Okay, if you're a nurse and you've ever gone into a patient's room and you're like, I have no idea where to even start with what has just been presented to me, I want to share with you, we already have a framework and we're going to talk about it. It's called inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation. We call it the IPPA method that guides all of our assessments when we come into a patient's room and we don't know where to start. So we're going to take care of that for you in this video today. Welcome back. My name is Tammy and this is NurseMinder, and on this channel we do everything nursing. So if you're new here, consider subscribing below so that you get the next video when it's released. Okay, so generally we move into the IPPA after we've done our health assessment. We've gathered information about why they're here, what their current issue is, their past medical history, allergies, medications, family history, that kind of stuff. That's already out of the way and now we're getting into IPPA. Sometimes though, we go right into our IPPA because you've walked into a situation, maybe you've got a patient on the floor and you don't really know what's going on. So we get a really brief summary and then we start our whole process before we lift them up off of the floor, right? So first, before we get into the lesson, I just want to share with you, if you are new here, help me reach my goal. I have a goal of 100,000 subscribers in 2021. And if you have never subscribed before or you find value in this, hit that subscribe button, hit the bell and the like button. What the bell does is it will notify you when the next video is released. And then that way you're gonna get it first before anybody else. Front of the line access. Okay, so it's no secret that I'm a nurse educator, but what's interesting to me is that when I ask students, tell me about your IPPA, I sometimes get this deer in the headlights look and I'm like, inspection? Palpation, percussion, auscultation. So I found it interesting that sometimes my students don't know. And I think what happens is they're so far removed from that theory because it's very at the very beginning of your physical assessment training that they need a little reminder. Although it's embedded in every single assessment you do when you do the respiratory system, the cardiovascular system, the GI system, we test you on this forever. So we're going to like give you some insider information today too. Okay. So let's talk about inspection first. Typically when students learn about inspection, they feel pretty awkward because they know they're going to be like staring at people. And when it comes to the respiratory assessment in particular, they feel really awkward because they're staring at the chest, right? So inspection is where you're going to use your senses of your eyes so that you can see what's going on. You do this now. When you're out in public and you notice somebody who looks well-dressed versus somebody who's disheveled, that's part of your inspection processes. What is the general appearance overall? And then when we focus it in on a system, that's when we get a little bit more detailed in what we're looking for. So let me just share with you, first of all, you do not have to stare at your patients to do your inspection. It's part of when you come in and you just have your general conversation with them and you're maybe doing a pulse check and you're noticing these things around you. And I will say that probably, unless your patient has something wrong, you don't really have your attention drawn to the fact that you're inspecting because there's nothing obvious outside of the norm. It's only when you do your focused assessment that you really hone in on things such as symmetry, or is the, you know, the vertebral column straight, or is there a little bit of a curve? We wouldn't normally pick that up when they're fully dressed, but you would notice that on your focused assessment. Now, inspection is the place that we always start. So let's talk about what that is. Now, when it comes to your inspection, we're really looking to see, do we have symmetry? What are the colors? You know, you expect your fingernails to be pink and not blue, for example. What is the movement? Do they have a shoulder hike or a limp? Those are kind of things you're doing just as a quick observation, and don't rush through that. Like if you need to see somebody in a different position, ask them to stand up, move, walk away, walk towards. That's all part of us gathering information to get a good idea of where they are. Now, when it comes to palpation, we're going to involve our hands and we're going to start to touch to see if there's any changes in temperature and moisture. Maybe there's some swelling or there's masses or lumps that you can't see on inspection, but that when you start to touch, you start to recognize, hey, you've got a little bit of a mass here. Is this normal? You want to find out if they've noticed it. You can also identify if there's any crepitus. So when you put your hand on their joints and you're moving them around, you might feel something that you can't hear, and that will give you some inside information about what's happening inside the joint. Now, when it comes to palpation, we have two types. We have light and deep. Typically, our light palpation is where you're going to use your fingertips, the pads of your fingers here, and that would be when you do like a pulse check and you're checking to see how bounding that pulse is. That's a palpation. Another type is when you're just kind of, you know, gently moving around the skin, or you're checking for lymph nodes, for example, we're going to use our finger pads and just gently rotate to see if we notice any swelling in those key areas for our lymph nodes. Now we can also use the back of our palm here to do a temperature check. And you can put it on their forehead, you can put it on their arm, and just get a sense with light palpation if they feel warm or cold. Now, deep palpation requires that we're taking our finger pads and we're pushing in deeper. And sometimes we're actually putting one hand underneath and another hand on top to really compress and feel what's going on in between. Deep palpation for nurses is typically when we would be assessing the abdomen and we're going to press a little deeper to see what's happening inside. All right, so let me know below if ever in your inspection or palpation, you actually found something abnormal and what happened. I remember there was a time we were doing a health fair and this fellow had this massive mole on the top of his head. And I remember saying to my teacher, oh my God, he's got a mole. Should I tell him? Yes, of course. But I didn't say anything until after he had left. And that was when I started to panic thinking, oh, I wonder if he knows. And so I kind of ran after him, sir, I don't know if you're aware of this, but you have a mole on the back of your head. And he kind of chuckled. He goes, yes, it's been there for a long time. So, but I felt like I had missed an opportunity to practice to my full scope and provide him with information because when I saw it, it was massive. I had never seen something like that before. Let me know in the comments below if you have found something that has changed the course of a patient's pathway as a result of your inspection or palpation. Now let's move on to the next two, percussion and auscultation. Now when it comes to percussion, this is where we're gonna actually do some tapping and we're gonna do gentle tapping to see what sound is elicited, right? So we can use this to help locate organs and their size of them. It can help us identify the density. So is there air in there? Is there fluid in there? Is it a solid mass? And now when it comes to doing your percussion, we're going to fan out our hand. Doesn't matter which one you use as the base and which one you use as the tap. You'll fan it out and we're going to use the middle finger and we'll put the base on the place you're going to percuss. And so if you're going to do, and I encourage you to do this at home, percuss your rib and then the space in between, and then the rib and the space in between. And notice the differences in tone. On your rib, because it's a firm structure, it will be a dull thud. Now the key thing is when you're percussing is you want to just strike twice and come up. Okay, you don't want to actually hold your hand there. So if I were to do it here, I would strike twice and my hand is lifted because if you keep your hand there, it will dull the sound. So you don't want to ever leave it on there. You want to take it off, okay? All right, and the fourth one is auscultation. So what we're going to be doing with auscultation is listening, and you're going to need a good stethoscope. And the systems that we're most likely to auscultate are the cardiovascular, the respiratory, and the GI system. You want to eliminate any extra noises that might actually impact. So if you've got somebody who has a hairy chest, and you put this on their chest and you're listening, you might find that you're getting some fine crackles as a result of the hair movement. Another one that you can have is movement from touching on the outside here of the stethoscope head. And so I tend to just put my two fingers here when I plant it. And then that way, as it's planted on there, I have a bit of a, you don't want to go too hard because too hard can make some noise too. But you'll find a nice light touch where you can support it without having to hear your fingers rubbing. And you'll know, like if you put your stethoscope in your ears and you put this down and you just start, just play around and you'll see what sounds you're going to make. And then you can reduce them. So maybe you're going to use two fingers, or maybe use the two fingers, like just a fingertip, sorry, or you can use two fingers. Maybe even get the cord out of your way. Lungs sound great. Now, of course, if you're listening through clothes, that can also cause some movement and some issues with getting a clear, crisp sound of what's really happening underneath. Every assessment you're going to do is going to follow this order except for one. And that's the abdomen. With the abdomen, we're gonna go inspect first, always, that never changes. Then we're gonna listen. And the reason we listen to the abdomen before we palpate and percuss is because as we palpate, we might create some sounds in there. So we're gonna listen first to see what's going on, and then we'll come back and palpate and percuss. Now you will find some system assessments you don't need to use all four. So for example, if I came in with a hand injury, we can inspect it, look for symmetry, deformities, swelling, color and changes if there's any redness. We can then palpate it and see if all of our joints feel okay. We're going to be fixing or working with all of those. Percussion, not likely to happen in the hand, and we're not going to listen to the hand. But what would we do if it was, say, a respiratory system? All right, so I'm going to show you the best I can with the limitations of being an office of one. We're going to look at the respiratory system. Why would I pick that one? Because it's the most common, I think. So I'm going to show you how to do your inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation in that order with a respiratory assessment. Let's give it a try, shall we? And I hope you have something more beneficial to practice on at home than yourself. But I tell you what, if you are the only thing you have to practice, do it. Because I will share with you when it comes to implementing it in terms of your testing, your CIAs, if that's what you call them, your clinical integration assessments, or in real life, if you don't practice, if you've never done it, it will feel like you're a fish out of water. So if you are the only thing you have, I'll demonstrate how you can do that on yourself. And if otherwise, maybe you've got like a stuffed animal or somebody else who's willing to be a patient for you, my husband never was, then you can practice on them. So let's get into the demo. Okay, so with your patient either sitting or standing, let's just go through the respiratory system as an example. So I'm going to turn to the side here. And part of your inspection is just to notice my effort of breathing. So is my breathing relaxed? Of course, I need to shut up for that. All right, so first inspection, we're going to notice any skin color changes. Are they pale and pink or blue? And we want them to be pink. You may need to ask them to remove a layer of clothing so that you can fully inspect their breathing effort. So on their inhalation, exhalation, is there equal rise and fall? Do they have any shoulder hiking or nasal flaring? And do they look like they're at rest with their breathing? Moving into palpation, you're going to start at the top of the chest on the anterior or posterior. You will do both. And then just palpate down to the lower level of the ribs where the lungs end. Looking for any masses, lesions, any lumps or bumps that maybe they're just not aware of. Now, of course, it's ideal if your patient is able to remove their top and you can fully inspect. With the top up, you can then do the chest expansion assessment where you put your hands at about the T9, T10, and then you have them take a deep breath in and exhale so you can assess for symmetrical rise and fall. Next, it's time to move into percussion. So let's just listen here. Notice the quick two strikes and then how the striking finger lifts up. When moving on to auscultation, you'll want to make sure you're listening for a full inhalation exhalation before you're moving on to the other side, and always listening right to left as you go down. If you have troubles hearing, it's advisable to ask the patient to inhale through the mouth, so really, really deep breath, and then exhale. Awesome. So let me know in the comments below, has any part of your assessment, inspection, palpation, percussion, or auscultation led to new information about a patient and changed their care plan? I'd love to hear how your work as a nurse is creating positive change. So please share that below. Second, share this with your nursing colleagues, because I will tell you, it isn't always something that people think about because they forget it if they're in a workplace that they haven't used it and they're far removed from their training where they have forgotten all about it. So sometimes it's more about bringing it forward and helping people out. So let's elevate the practice of those around us and share this video with your friends. Third, if you haven't, subscribe below. Remember, I've got a goal, 100,000 subscribers in 2021. And you are a part of my vision. So subscribe, share, and like. We'll see you in the next video.
Hey, I know you're probably not ready to get off your phone or go back to work just yet, or maybe even turn the lights off to go to sleep. So why don't you spend a little bit more time here watching another video?